Do you wonder where your food comes from? More and more people do. America's corn farmers work hard every day to grow a crop that you can be proud to serve your family. And they're doing it with an eye toward sustainability, caring for water, air, soil, and resources that fuel healthy families and more sustainable products. Take a look to find out how farmers in rural America work to make life better for all of us, from cities to their rural communities. Learn more at ncga.com. NCGA, a commitment to the future.
Everyone loves happy hour, and no one makes an hour happier than actress, comedian, author, host, and self-proclaimed hat girl, Dee Dee Sorvino, who each show serves up an hour of good times and great conversation. Food, culture, fashion, current events, history, or just good gossip. Grab a cocktail and take a seat as Dee Dee shares stories, talks with friends, and makes you wish you could keep the bar tab open all night. Where there's a party, there's Dee Dee, and you are invited. Sit back, relax, and enjoy Drinks with Dee Dee. Here's your host, Dee Dee Sorvino.
Hello, hello, and welcome to Drinks with Dee Dee. We are drinking. I'm sure you're shocked. I mean, if you want to listen to the show and you are like, I only want to go to church and I don't want any mishmash, no mishmash, no mischief, no problems. I'm for prohibition. Okay, bye bye. This show is fun and freewheeling because you never know what's going to happen. And, you know, we'd love for you to join us on all the shows because they're all great. So with that, let's figure out, well, I already know what it is, but I'm going to let you know what the drink is of the show. And the theme is the Olympics. Dun, 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 dun. Dun, 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 dun. Okay. Chariots of Fire. How do you not know that? Well, if you're not as old as dirt like me, you might not. Anyway, that was a show that was like based on the Olympic Games. There are a few of them, and we have our wonderful film critic on this week, and he can talk about that because he knows all. But I decided to go with sake. Okay, now look, I'm Team USA, no doubt about it, but I went with the special sake, you know, because the Olympics are in Tokyo. So one in Rome, one in Tokyo. So I haven't even tried it yet, but the name of the sake is Born Gold. So I thought that would bring good luck to our athletes, our American athletes, who are doing great, by the way. But yeah, it's called Born Gold. And it was a little bit pricey, actually. So let's check it out. And then let's bring in our guest. Because, you know, we got to open up the bar. That's what we do here. We just open up the bar, bring folks in. And, you know, and all I do is tell them the topic. I said, this is the topic, and bring alcohol. And that's it. That's the only prep. We don't do prep here because who has time for that? And who wants to do that? I get cool people on that are ready to just talk bar talk.
And USA! 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 USA!
Hey, hey, Jennifer, Matthew, and then Michael, your beard looks alive. You look like there's a squirrel living in your beard.
This is what you have to look forward to.
Hey, Matthew's looking good.
I remember when mine was dark.
Oh, yeah. Well, yeah, you're going to get there, Michael. You know, but it looks good, Matthew. I like it. You know, yours kind of works, Michael. I mean, I don't know. Jennifer, help me. Do you think Michael should have a beard or not? Now, Matthew's looks good. But what do you think about Michael?
I think you should do it suits the mood because I saw a picture of him with like his podcast when he was all like clean. And I was like, dude, that's the same person.
I know. Different.
No, it's kind of like you can have an Instagram called The Beard, and you know, you just kind of place yourself in different places or whatever. It's become sort of a second person or a buddy of yours, like that's your buddy. Buddy the Beard.
More confidence, it takes over sometimes. I'll be like, fuck you. Oh, sorry, that was The Beard.
No, you should be like, oh, your name's Delia. Oh, get the fuck out of there. because you know, I know you don't read the Bible, but when Kirk comes on, he can explain to you the Samson and Delilah story.
Speaking of the devil, speak of the angel.
Very nice, Matthew. Speak of the devil, Kurt. He's really the angel. But Kurt, I was talking to Michael about his beard and how big it's getting, like it's a person or a thing or a, I don't know what. And I said, just run if you get close to someone named Delilah. And since he doesn't go to church, since he's like a bad boy, he doesn't know who that is. So maybe you can explain that.
Oh my goodness. I would have thought at the very least seeing Victor Mature movies would clue you in.
They were Sodom and Gomorrah's roommates.
Well, yeah, probably. Well, they were just down the road. Samson and Delilah. Samson was one of the early leaders of the Israelites before the kings. And his great thing was, as long as he didn't get his hair cut, he still had his strength. Yeah, so if you get your hair cut, and the person who cut his hair was Delilah, who was one of those women from the wrong side of the tracks, you know.
She's soft FM radio?
She's
over there by me in the trailer, okay? Me and Delilah, you know, we're next door neighbors, because we like it over there by the trailer. We want to be on the wrong side of the track, because it's more fun.
Well, you know, you describe people as a Philistine sometimes. She really was. I mean, she literally. So that was on her passport. So there you go.
So it's a star-studded cast at the bar today. We've got Jennifer Ruby, the beautiful ruby lip Jennifer Ruby. Yay. And then we've got Matthew Sochi. Okay, Sochi. Now I know that's how do you say it?
Sochi, like sociology.
No, Sochi. You know why I'm saying that?
I know, because you're trying to fit this all into the theme of this week's thing.
And you know I love themes, so it's
I love people mispronouncing my name, so that's
not Matthew Sochi, but that's why I want to do the Mickey Mouse. What is it? The Mickey Mouse Mickey
roll call.
Mickey. Yeah, so we could like get Sochi in, but it's really Sochi. Saucy.
Thank you.
Saucy. You're saucy. And then Vin Gaetano. Now I know that's not right either. I'm just being bad today. So
Close enough.
How do you? Yeah, I don't know Italian. What you know? How do you say that? The Italians, those long, funny names. I can't get them all right. I know Sorbino.
Yeah, there. We talked about it a while back.
I know.
So a friend of mine who actually makes documentaries, he does little tours of locations in Brooklyn and New York City, where they film mobster movies. His name is actually Gaetano Peretta. So we talked about that. And his family, the way he pronounces it is Gaetano, like G-U-Y-T-A-N-O. So I say my last name the same way, Gaetano. There's a restaurant.
Like gay, though, because Gaetano, it's kind of like you're gay and happy.
Yeah, well.
I kind of like it.
Yeah, that was tough in high school. There's a restaurant here in town. There's another one in Stratford. And I asked them. In fact, there's a cool restaurant in Italy, there's a couple of them, and they have the same name, and I'll ask them, and they all say G-U-Y, so Gaetano. The French part of that is Gaetan, G-A-E-T-O-N, and that's different, but so it is what it is, but having me. I might have some things to contribute along Olympic themes today.
Oh, good. I'm glad. You know what? Yeah. Because you never contribute anything. You never have. So this was your last.
Well, that's why I'm afraid. That's what I was afraid of.
It was your last chance. So I'm glad you're finally going to be able to, you know, get yourself out of the doghouse. All right, everybody. You're always in the doghouse, Michael. I don't even know why you're here. I had you blocked. So somehow you got you're tricky. You always get in. All right. So what is everyone drinking? And then we'll talk Olympics. Jennifer, my dear, I love your lipstick. What are you drinking?
I am drinking just a plain screwdriver, vodka, and orange juice.
Boy, does that work in the summer? I drink a lot of them. I prefer a Greyhound. But, you know, with the grapefruit juice.
Healthy.
It's totally healthy. And, of course, Michael will go back. I'm not even going to ask you because it's Hornitos all the way, which you really need to get that sponsor. I'm going to write it myself. It's so pathetic. I should get the sponsor. What am I talking about? I'm giving you the sponsor. But we're not about money here, even though we're making millions of dollars. It doesn't matter.
A million?
Million. I mean, I can't even tell you. It's top secret how it's happening. So Matthew, what are you having? You're our movie guy.
What's it all about? Malfi.
What's it all about?
The Middle-y.
Did you like the Jude Law Alfie or the Michael Caine Alfie? Am I right? Was it Michael Caine Alfie?
Yeah, Michael Caine did it first. The Jude Law version is fine, but it's not Michael Caine's Alfie. So perfectly. It's, you know what? An original and a remake can exist in the world, and nobody turns into hell in a handbag because of it. So
Michael Caine.
No, you're not. Not even close.
Blame it on Rio. You know, I want to like Michael Caine, and then I think of Blame It on Rio, and it's just hard to kind of get over that. I want to like that movie, but
Well, to borrow a line, not from that film, but from another film, you may not have liked the film, but he loved The View from the House
that got
him that movie. So
I'm sure he loved The View through the whole movie because he got quite an eyeful.
He did get an eyeful.
Everyone got an eyeful in that movie.
Yes, we did.
All right. What's it all about? I want to sing it again. I like that tune.
What?
But what is it?
It's an Italian gin.
Gin. Italian gin. Okay. Mm-hmm. Very nice. Is it Amalfi? Is it from the Amalfi Coast?
Could be.
Okay. So Vin, what are you having?
So I'm trying to get rid of a few of these. I had gotten these from a vendor, actually. We were supposed to do a kind of a virtual happy hour. This is from California. It is Ambitious Ales Hike School. And frankly, I'm going to stick to my New England beers. They're just so good.
That sounds good. You know, California won't even let you go into restaurants now unless you've got the COVID passport. I've got my passport, but I don't have the COVID passport, so I'm not going to go to California for a while because I want to eat. I like to eat and drink. No bars in California for me. I don't know. I won't even, because it's private. If you offer your passport, but I don't have it, so I can't go eat out there. Oh, is that separate?
You mean a passport separate from your regular vaccine card?
That's what it is. I mean, passport. You know, probably in LA they have to, do something squirrely with it. I don't know. Our wonderful producer might know.
Yeah. Are you? You're not back in New York yet?
No, we're in Tallahassee, Florida, doing a movie.
Oh, that's right. I saw that. So yeah. New York decides, and I'm sorry that folks that have to live there, they're deciding that they're not going to allow a number of unvaccinated people into their establishments in the city. And I don't like that, of course, but most of the unvaccinated folks are the Black, the African, and the Hispanic community.
You leper, you unvaccinated.
No,
leper.
It's really.
And they just say, you're all lepers. You just go to that island. Remember in Jezebel when the dude had to go to the island because he had the yellow jack? Matthew, is there finally a movie you don't know? Do you know the part? Do you know Jezebel whenever they sent Henry Fonda and
Barbara Stanwyck, right? It's been a while. Betty Davis, sorry.
His wife looked like Barbara Stanwyck, but Betty Davis went.
No, it's been like a thousand years since I've watched Jezebel, so I will add it to my list.
I love it, but it seems like, I'll put that on that list that you always put out because Matthew, you should follow him because he is a film critic for PBS. He's like a big deal. And he's very good at it. So you should follow him because he asks every week, I believe it's every week, like what movies you watch or whatever. And he's really, really so good. And he's part of our family. So we want to support him. Yay, Matthew.
Thank you, love. Thank you, friends. Appreciate it.
And if you have a website, what is it? If they want to follow you to do the
film. Well, it's WFYI.org. And the film is called, the show is called Film Sociology. And that's Sociology. Yeah, I know. Clever. So there's that. Actually, while we're in shameless plugging news, I also do a blues show on Saturday nights called the Blues House Party, and the show just got picked up by WBAA, which is Purdue University's public station. So the empire is growing, and
you are a Boilermaker.
Shot in a beer is not bad. Not bad.
I want to pitch a show with you. I want it to be called Getting Saucy with Sosie.
If Food Network
saucy with saucy. I love it.
if That's Food so Network good. Gives me some of that Food Network money, I'll consider it.
Saucy Sosie, yeah. Well, never forget your home's here. So when you get all rich and famous and you don't have time for us anymore, I hope
now I gotta eat Madison sometime
during the holiday or Hanukkah, whatever, you'll come and visit us after. Yes, you know, dear.
You know, I will. We're trying, I'm trying to plan a trip south.
Do you play or do you sing the blues?
Oh, no, the play button on the disc player, that's my instrument.
Oh, I love it. So you're like a DJ. Ah, he's a DJ. That's right.
That's right.
You are DJ. A blues DJ.
Yeah, DJ NPR. So that's my show ends at like 10 p.m.
That's great. No. Well, Kurt shows like at the retirement home. It ends.
Kurt, I love watching movie night pictures. That's been cool.
I post up on Facebook every time we do movies at the retirement community, in part to show the people who are in charge who aren't there on the weekends that I showed up and I'm showing the movie.
Give me my money.
It just sort of became a thing, and I people who know my residents try and guess who's in the audience by the back of their heads.
what's the most scandalous shit you've shown them?
I think probably the sex scene in Sideways.
Did ambulance have to come?
No,
but guy almost did.
Did you get oxygen?
Here's the thing.
You're so saucy.
I'm also the chaplain there, so I have to be a little bit careful on what I show.
Oh, I see. So a guy's junk on a car window. That's where the line is drawn.
So, speaking of the guy's junk, the ladies went to our
we're going there quick today at the retirement home. Yeah.
The ladies went to our activity director and asked her if she would arrange a trip out to the theater to see Magic Mike because they didn't think that I would be willing to show it.
But you did, didn't you?
So I didn't, because they all went to that.
You know, Matthew loves Magic Mike, remember? Matthew loves Magic Mike. He's
Magic
a big fan.
Mike is basically Steven Soderbergh's version of Boogie Nights.
Yeah.
It's a story about a 30-year-old male stripper, which I said is like a 40-year-old Hooters waitress. And I think every female wanted the male stripper show without the 2-drink minimum and the cover and the walk of shame. And they got miffed that it was not all wall-to-wall Channing Tatum dancing, that all this dialogue, you know, they sounded like guys. Like, what's all this dialogue and story getting in the way? It was not quite what they cracked up to be. I thought you would have shown him like Jane Russell in The Outlaw would have been the most scandalous, but kudos to you on Sideways.
No, we get modern and I have people. Of course, that one was a suggestion, so I can always hide behind the, well, someone asked for it, requested it.
So if somebody asked for Last Tango, that's
I'll let them do that on the Thursday afternoon shows that I don't run.
Excellent.
So.
Speaking of watching stuff, first we'll get Kurt's drink of the show. What are you having, Kurt?
My drink is something different today. I actually have Veuve Clicquot today.
My favorite. Wow.
And the reason I have Veuve Clicquot is because just yesterday I got my final grade and I am now officially the holder of an MBA.
Congratulations. Lachaim.
I got that from the American Military University, where I used to teach for about 10 years.
And don't you have like 5 other MBAs or something? This is
my 5th master's degree with that university. So this is my 5th and final one, because in 2 weeks I start with Vanderbilt on a doctorate. But I'm drinking the champagne to celebrate.
Great. Well, toast to Kurt. Congratulations. Yeah. Yay. Exactly. Congratulations. Chaplain of America. Chaplain of the world. That's what he's going to school for, to be the best chaplain in the world. And he already,
I am trying to be. So.
Best chaplain in America.
Best chaplain in America. USA. USA, give me that Bible. Woo! So we've got lots to celebrate. I mean, I have these sad, well, next to Kurt, it sounds sad, and next to Matthew, it sounds sad, but I have a little accomplishment. I finished my class for Harvard, well, it's actually not Harvard Extension, it's Harvard Summer School.
Sure. All right.
It goes towards Harvard Extension, but I finished my class, and this was my most difficult class because it was street dance activism. Now, who would think I would take that? You're either going to think, yeah, she would do that, or like, why would anybody do that? What is that? I wasn't even sure, and it wasn't what I thought.
Masks and vaccines have to go.
Something like that. And I'm like, I'm going to get an A or an F. I'm going to do really well with this, or I'm going to flunk it. They are not going to get me. They're going to hate me. I mean, because for one, it's like a Black Lives Matter kind of thing or whatever. I'm really white, and I'm from Kentucky, and I may not fit in. But it's that, I thought, well, that shouldn't matter because I like learning and learning about things, and I think that, you know, activism on the street sounded interesting. So I did it, and I got an A!
Hey.
But it was hard. I had to really kind of pay attention, and I had to dance. That part I liked. That was like, I danced every week. I got my baton out, and I danced to ABBA. And I danced Oingo Boingo, and I promise you, I was the only one doing that. They're like, who is that crazy old white lady? I don't know, but if she's going to do this.
Oh, Danny Elfman, he turned it. I didn't know he had a legit 80s rock band.
Yeah.
It's the Dead Man's Party.
Yeah, I love Dead Man's Party.
But what did Danny Elfman sing? Was that his band?
Yeah, that's
he Elfman. Was Oingo Boingo? That was the guy singing? And you know, remember when Robert Downey, I mean, this is a show in itself because I love this movie, but Robert Downey Jr. gets down on the floor and puts his legs up in the air and does this to Rodney Dangerfield, and Rodney Danger said, you're a poster child for Planned Parenthood or something.
Yeah.
Well, at the beginning of the movie, he's communist. He's like, guys like you and me never have a shot in America. Then he walks in the dorm room, and it's like all tricked out. And then at the graduation, smoking a pipe and a jacket, he's like, oh, yes.
Downey does that same move every time a Marvel check arrives.
And then he does the triple Lindy, you know, and like he's real fat, and you know, and it's just so great. You know, and then he does all the best parties. So anyway, I kind of modeled myself after Rodney Dangerfield. But then it's like I'm amateur next to Kurt after 5 MBAs. I'm just trying to get one. I'm trying to survive.
Not a problem. It's cool. Congrats.
Thank you.
No. Some people collect baseball cards. I collect degrees. It's the same thing. So.
And now you're going for the big enchilada. You're going to be a doctor. It's going to be doctor, honorable, pastor, priest, father, Kurt.
Something like that, yeah. The right honorable and very reverend father doctor. Yeah.
Yeah. We'll just use doctor for a while because that's totally cool. All right.
Congratulations. If you have experience dancing with ABBA, though, let me tell you, you need to go to Stockholm to the ABBA Museum, because at the ABBA Museum, they have holographic ABBA people that you can get up on stage and dance with, and they'll give you a video of your dancing and singing with ABBA.
Oh, I am there. We got to take drinks with Dee Dee over there to do the ABBA show. I'm telling you, we're getting big.
And the theme would be Stockholm Syndrome. Kidnap and take them to Stockholm and hold them at the ABBA Museum until they dance. It has to be a dance off to be released. Yes.
Does your mother know that you're out? Take it easy, take it easy, take it nice and slow. La 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 la. Does your mother know? Did you all know that was an ABBA song?
Yes.
Okay. You know all of them.
I'm got the words. 1 and 2.
All right. Well, I know that you love the stage version, Michael. I know you love that. You know what it is. You know what I'm talking about, right? Does anyone know what I'm talking about?
Mamma Mia?
Yeah.
I never watched the stage version. You probably knew that, but.
You're all right, Michael.
Say that because I'm a girl. You're a misogynist. You're so bad. I mean, you know, you were making fun of whenever I said I wouldn't like gay and you didn't like it and you're a misogynist. And, you know, you look, Michael, just because you're from Kentucky doesn't give you the right to be mean to people. Okay. I'm just letting you know. I'm letting you know. Okay, I'm kidding, of course. But let's talk about the Olympics. Okay, go ahead, USA guy, bearded guy.
I was gonna text you a clip of this, but I finally got to watch our Kentucky comedy show. And I'll send this clip to you, but this guy walks in a red vest. you're like, whoa, who are you? And then he's like, oh, I'm here to see my sister. Then he walks in and you go, you look like the Back to the Future guy. And then you started singing on the catwalk. Yeah, on the catwalk.
On the catwalk.
And then you go, and then the best part is you go, in your wrinkly jeans on the catwalk. I'll send you the clip.
It's our joke, Michael, but that's okay. Next time we do a comedy show, you're all in it. And whether in the audience or in the show or at the end with the dance part, because it's just what happens. Especially now that I've taken street dance activism, I'm all about, you know, my moves now. So now the show is going to be expanded into, and in fact, my paper was about how we need to bring back, and I know some of you did this show already, and I said it ad nauseum, but bringing back American Bandstand and Soul Train, and I got an A. All I know is thank you for letting me talk about and getting through my paper on the show, because it got me a good grade. Thank you.
Good.
Very good.
Well, let's talk about the Olympics.
USA.
I mean, I love the Olympics. In fact, Paul and I were really late for something. We were supposed to get down the road, and we were like 2 hours late because we didn't know that they were the Olympic team, the USA team, and it's always last, you know, whenever they come out in the beginning. And I had to see it. I felt like, oh, we got to watch it. And Paul's like, all right, we'll just do this. And it caused a chain. I mean, it was bad. I mean, it was bad that we were so late. It caused all kinds of problems. Domino effect of disaster. But we did see the team come in, and they look great. And you know, I started tearing up because I can't help it. I don't know about you all, but I love the Olympics because it's this wonderful patriotic thing. And the USA just always kicks ass. Mm-hmm. And we do have some wonderful Olympians that are just saying, I love this country. It's great. I'm so proud to represent. And that's just so nice to hear. So have you all watched it? What do you think, Jennifer? Have you watched the Olympics? I mean, are you enjoying it?
I'm enjoying what I can see. I mean, there's been some protests and things that I've not been crazy about and some negative publicity on specific athletes. But other than that, I always think it's such a patriotic thing that we can do to do things. Plus, I found out that my sister-in-law's niece is running in track and field. So that's been kind of funny.
Wow. Cool.
When does she run? Well, I'll cheer her on.
I'll send you the details. I've got to pull the information. I'd have to like shut down my...
Send her good vibes. Yeah, I mean,
but it's kind of exciting to actually know, kind of have skin in the game. And I know somebody who knows somebody, or I'm related to kind of by marriage to somebody who's actually in the Olympics.
I think it still counts.
And still counts, and it's awesome. So yeah, well, actually the connect I sort of quasi have is because, you know, we have a place in Madison, and the Fink family, the father of Fink, you know, the swimmer Fink, that like, I don't remember his first name, the kid Fink, and he won, and it was really cool that event. And then all over my, you know, the page is like, oh my gosh, so-and-so's son won the gold medal, and so his dad went to Madison High School, so people in Madison knew the family, so it's pretty cool. And Indiana, you know, you, Michael, a problem?
Bless you.
You didn't even, you went right in the beard, so your beard is really gross right now. I mean, you probably have COVID just because of that.
No,
I will give you COVID. Everything gives you COVID. Everybody's got COVID.
My favorite part of the Olympics is the crowd just going wild, watching all the Olympians train their whole fucking lives. They sacrifice their social lives. Then who do they perform in front of? Nobody. Nobody. It's a shame. It's a travesty. You're an idiot if you don't think that these people need to perform in front of people. Anyway, sorry.
I'm sorry. It's also their job. I mean, this is what they were trained to do. whether there's 10 people or 1,000. The show must go on. Yes, I'm mixing arts with my sports. So, yeah.
Well, but at the same time, they're used to practicing without a crowd. So,
exactly.
So they this feels sort of natural to a lot of them. Mm-hmm. Some of them actually perform worse in front of crowds because that's not how they usually do it. So it'll be interesting to see if anyone does a study. I'd be interested in this to see how athletic performance goes through this Olympics versus other Olympics where they have crowds, and if there's any kind of statistically significant difference between those, whether we break more records, whether we have more medals awarded for some countries versus others, it makes a big difference.
I have a personal case study. I went to an A's game, an Oakland A's game. As you know, they are a terrible baseball team. They were playing the Baltimore Orioles. I was on third baseline, and the pitcher for the A's was going into the dugout, and I was just like, okay, watch this. I'm gonna hype this guy up. I knew nothing about the team. I just knew the guy's name was Mike, and I yell at him. I go, get him, Big Mike! And then he points at me. He goes, mm-hmm. And then he runs out there to the mound, first inning. Wha-bam! 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 He strikes all three batters out. He comes back. I'm like, Big Mike!
speaking of athletics, Vin has to leave at 5 because he has cardio tennis. I can't hear that. You're leaving drinking at our bar for cardio tennis. So please, Vin, fill us in.
It actually, believe it or not, my Olympics, we do
your Olympic trainer. What? Your Olympic what? Your trainer? Your friend?
We do. Our trainer, our coach, has actually trained somebody that went to the Olympics, and a couple of, I think he was a tennis coach to Stefan Edberg for a while, but he, so it's fun. It's kind of like an hour and a half cardio point play. And we
I mean,
do a
you have to do it today. I mean, don't you think it's more important to drink with us and go to cardio?
I could do both. It's well,
can't you go late? Could you be fashionably late? You got the hat.
No, because then the girls will be mad. But I do want to show you a picture. I actually had this on my desk. This is me and Tommy Mo. Tommy Mo won a gold medal in 1994.
And of course, Kurt's shaking. I mean, nodding like, "Oh yeah, I know Tommy."
Oh, this guy's got the life. This guy's got the life. So anyway, we were in Jackson Hole, Wyoming, and we
Jackson
got
Jackson Hole. Tommy Mills in Jackson Hole.
Yep. No, it was a cool story, Aditi. And we got to ski with him. I was with my ski club group, about 60 of us, and we all had an opportunity to go up the gondola with Tommy Mo, gold medal winner. Ambassador. Yep. And he was so cool. And then we skied down with him. So we got personal lessons, and we get back down and nobody was there waiting for him to go back up. So we ended up skiing with him all morning, and we had our own personal lessons with him. And just something he said to me, and I brought this up on interviews and different things. And I had said, when you're coming down the mountain at 70 to 80 miles an hour, how do you not focus on crash into those gates, those nets and whatever? And he said, what gates? I said, the posts and all that. And he laughs. He says, Vin, I can't focus on those. I'm coming down so fast. I can only focus on, you know, the area within 6 to 10 inches of the gate. So he goes, we're Olympians. He goes, we don't focus on obstacles. We focus on the path. And I remember exactly, I literally have it written on the back of this. And we love that story, and I've used it a couple of times. And he was so cool. And if you ever, he's still out there skiing. If you're ever in Jackson Hole, we can probably ski one run with him. And he's a lot of fun. But I got to meet a couple of Olympians when I used to drive tennis players around. We had a tournament in New Haven, and a lot of them were in the Olympics in 1996 in Atlanta. And I had mentioned all of my ski club trips, they're to Olympic venues, Cortina, Italy, Montreal, and then Utah, of course, I think three wow. times. Yeah, so they're fun.
Tommy,
yeah.
It's a trademark to him. I want to say, hey, Tommy, t-shirts.
No, your role, not the pole. No, he's worth it. And Lake Placid, everybody, please get to Lake Placid, New York, if you can. The magic that happened up there in 1980, the town, they held the Olympics twice. And there was a great story about a family from Connecticut where the grandfather was a speed skater in 1932. His son was a luger in 1980. And then his son, did the luge in Utah in 2002. Three generations of the same family from a little town in Connecticut. There's so much cool history with the Olympics.
Ben, is Lake Placid doing all right financially?
They're a smaller resort. People would rather, if the economy is good, the Americans go to Europe. If the economy is not so good, they still, I mean, it's okay. It's not a great mountain. It never really was updated. It's not easy to get to.
I don't even know where it is. What part of New York is it? I assume north.
It's upstate New York. It's Lake Placid, New York, near the big lake. It's about 3 hours north of the city. It's about 5 hours from me in Connecticut, but we go a lot. The food is pretty good up there, but there's a lot of history. Just to go into you'll see the venue where the magic happened with the hockey team, and it is so tiny. It's like 15,000 seats compared to the monsters that they make today. And it was like it looked like a little auditorium. That's how small it was.
But I guess I'm thinking of like when I know Montreal was hit financially when they hosted it at 76. So I wondered, and I know other cities that would just put up stadiums and arenas, you know, almost kind of disposable. So I'm guessing they already had the facilities and also in the surrounding areas.
They had like the old in the 30, I think it was 32, the Olympics in 32, like the speed skating was a big outdoor track. They maintained that. There weren't a lot of the what we heard were the logistics. The road up there was like a little state highway. So the logistics just to get people up there in trucks and satellite trucks in 1980 when they were much bigger was a real challenge. And they didn't really, I mean, they double bunked Olympians, and they weren't that big like they are today. But the town is still there. It's a part of history because it held the Olympics twice, plus also what happened with the Americans and the Russian hockey game was just, it's just locked in history.
And why don't you tell us about that? Because a lot of our listeners probably have no idea what happened.
What's that? That game.
It
was an amateur hockey team. A lot of them were amateurs. Some of them were in college. They were not paid professionally, whereas the Russian hockey players were. That was a challenge. And they were, of course, expected to get walloped. This team there was a couple of movies. I think Kurt Russell was in one
Miracle
movie.
Yeah.
Miracle.
There's a great 30 for 30 about the Russian team. And I can't remember if it was ESPN or not, but there is a documentary just as compelling about the Russian team.
Yeah, and I hope I'm accurate about that, but I remember hearing that they were more professionals and like they could transfer from the NHL to the Russian Olympic team, whereas in the United States, like we have professional basketballers now, but we could not have. You played amateur with no money, or you played professionally for the Knicks, and they won 1-0. I think the game was.
Yeah. The Russians taught grizzly bears how to ice skate. They don't mess around.
They're tough. Yeah, but please go up there. It's a lot of fun. It's a the ski jump venue has a zip line, Didi, you can actually hold on. And you can come down. They'll push you down almost down the.
Push you down.
The ski jump. But you simulate the ski jump on a zip line. You could still ride the bobsleds. We did that. No, we've been to Lake Placid 4 or 5 times.
Yeah. And mention this? Did you all see Cool Runnings by chance?
Yes. I forgot.
We're talking about winter, but you know, Paul was almost John Candy.
Oh no!
I swear, Paul, it was so funny because Paul told me we were watching. I said, "Oh, I love this movie. I want to watch it." And he's like, "I don't want to watch it." I said, "Why not?" You know, I'm not going to go to that movie that we don't mention unless I'm in a bad.
Nope. Oh, I was going to say the Dances with Wolves or sports films.
Dances with Wolves, the worst freaking fucking movie in all time. Don't ever see it. It's the trashiest bull. There is the worst cinematography. How can you ever watch it? Nobody likes it. It is stupid. Screw Dances with Wolves. But
we now return to our regularly scheduled program.
There were actually several movies about that hockey game, and the one I remember sort of best is not the Kurt Russell one. There was a made-for-TV movie right like the year after it happened with that starred Carl Malden and a very young Steve Guttenberg called like Miracle on Ice or something like that.
Yeah.
You can almost never find that anywhere, but Carl Malden was off of his Streets of San Francisco time, so he was sort of still a TV star anyway. And Steve Guttenberg, nobody knew who he was at the time. But it was interesting that's been remade over and over and over again. And that was a really iconic thing. And of course, we entered the Reagan era right after that, and it's like America's coming back kind of thing.
Yep.
So yeah, it shows that the power that the Olympics can have.
I mean, I love the Olympics. You know, I thought it was sad, you know, when people started saying, well, I'm all for free speech and I will get the musket out to defend everybody's right for free speech, but it doesn't mean I'm not going to slap you around or call you a hoe or call you a name for bashing the United States of America. This one I am mad about. Do not be on the USA team and bash America or say, I'm you, I'm that. And guess what? None of those people got medals. Ha! Hello. Bye bye. Bye bye. High chair.
You got beat by Canada.
Dee Dee, you mentioned Cool Runnings.
Do you want to raise your fist while you're saying that?
Yeah. I know where you're going.
Okay, you're 68. Mm-hmm.
Vin leaves to go to cardio tennis, and I have to ask, since this is a sport of sorts, is that a video game?
No, it's a real tennis. It'll be an hour and a half of me running around with people that are better players than me.
No, but why do you call it cardio tennis? Isn't it obvious that tennis is cardio? I mean,
well, it's like a drill, Dee Dee, and it's like a lesson at the same time, and we learn different strategies about approaching and winning at tennis rather than just playing and wasting time. I try to get better at things or else I stop doing them.
So you're like an Olympian. I mean, it's a job for you. You are serious about tennis.
So another time I'll tell you what Tommy Moe's side job is.
Tommy Moe!
So just one more thing, just quick. You mentioned Cool Runnings. I also got to go to Banff up in north of Calgary, Canada, once on a President Club trip, which was really nice, all paid for. We stayed at the beautiful Banff Springs Hotel. And turns out some of my friends went dog sledding, and they went dog sledding at the very place where they filmed a lot of that Cool Running. So they had pictures of John Candy in town. So it's just north of Calgary, really gorgeous part of this continent. I love the United States, but
you
I love going
Canada.
To Western.
You are totally a Canada-phile.
Well, I'll tell you what, please get to Banff. I think we can start going back to Canada now, but Western Canada is so much more different than Quebec.
What's your favorite city in Canada?
So I go to Montreal a lot, but I go to Quebec City a lot because I think I've been to Quebec City 7 or 8 times. Because you can stay in the city. It's a beautiful hotel called the Hotel Frontenac. And then we can ski. We get on the bus early, 7 o'clock in the morning, and a half hour later, we're at one of two different ski resorts. And one of them is right on the river. And you actually start at the top of the mountain. You ski down. At the end of the day, you have to take your gondola back up. That's where your buses and your cars are.
So you're skiing up the hill barefoot in the snow, and then you take a gondola?
No, we're skiing downhill, but we're so close. It's so close to the St. Lawrence River. It's literally almost, it's almost at sea level. But we start at the top of the mountain. But it's a beautiful city. And please, before you go, I have a list of great places to eat. A secret pub. Okay. Yeah. And that's it. I've taken enough time.
We love speakeasies. Was it a speakeasy? Did they have those in Canada?
It was actually, Dee Dee. We had to go up a very steep street. It was, you know, 20 below zero, like it is in Quebec in January. And it was a big rock wall. This city was built in the 1600s. I think it's the only walled city north of Mexico.
Excuse this. I want to make sure I've got the Fort City right.
It's Quebec City, so it's okay. About 2 hours east of Montreal. You go up the river, but there's funny. We had to walk up the street, and we had to push on the rock wall, and there was a secret door. I didn't know where they were taking me. I didn't want to end up in something like New York, you know, in the 70s. And I pushed, and then the door opens up, and there is a tiny little bar with jazz music. Four beers. All they have is colored beers, like blonde, dark red, or the rouge, or something like that, and the white, and that's it. It's just a cute city, and there's a lot of cool military history there, and they fought their asses off during their Revolutionary War, and a lot of soldiers died there.
Well, yeah. But a lot of people drank there, and they fought to drink there, yep. So you know, and they started early, so we have to applaud that. And yeah. Was there ever a movie made there, Matthew, in Quebec City? Is there anything about Quebec City that you know about?
Quite a few, I'm sure. I could look that up if you like.
Matthew, I can answer one of the questions. There was a great movie with Ethan Hawke and beautiful Angelina Jolie. She was like an FBI person, and they filmed it there. And the hotel is so iconic. Huh?
Taking Lives.
Maybe, yeah. Yeah, and the hotel is so iconic, so you recognize it in every movie. There was a great movie with... Bruce Willis, I think it was The Jackal, and part of it was
Day of the Jackal.
Yeah. And believe it or not, the guy that built the turret for his gun was a young Jack Black. But Richard Gere was in the movie, and when Bruce Willis entered,
wait a minute, Jack Black did what with the gun?
Yes, he was kind of a machinist. It was really funny.
Oh yeah, I believe that. Jack Black.
No, it was funny. Before he became
capital J, capital B. Yeah, he was that spastic guy. He was also a computer hacker in Enemy of the State way back then.
And Bob Roberts. He looks fully like a computer hacker. Putting a gun in that guy's hands.
He had a very horrible ending in this movie.
Yeah.
Bruce Willis was not a good guy. And I love Bruce Willis, but
I know him. He's so nice. I worked with him in the White House. Great guy.
Yeah.
But I don't see Jack Black with the gun and surviving. I don't know. So then, as you're going to cardio tennis,
I have time for you guys. It's not till 7, but I need to warm up.
Okay.
Oh, we want to see that.
Why don't you warm up right here? Turn on the music. We'll just sit here.
No, it's not. It's not.
I'm using that in street dance activism. I mean, you've got to loosen up. You got to feel free to be able to dance.
Or well. Speaking of Olympics, do you have the proper shorts to wear as you're warming up?
Yes.
Speedos.
Yeah.
I'll go through two shirts and two towels in 90 minutes, but it's fun for me. It's good for me. And I'm actually getting better now that I'm keeping score at tennis. So it serves its purpose.
Cool.
Well, I have to have you back to learn about your time with cardio tennis.
I've done it before. I've mentioned it to you before.
I know, but still, you said you didn't have to leave the show to go to cardio tennis. So of course, you know, it must be very important to you, and we all support that effort.
You are all important.
Go for it, cardio tennis.
I gotta put
But I do have a question for you, which I'll ask everybody. Do you prefer Bruce Jenner at the Olympics or running for governor of California?
I know. I don't know.
He was a hero.
I don't.
I was a kid, so I have issues.
Nobody can tell me. Nobody knows what they think about Bruce. Okay, what's the name now? I forgot. Caitlyn.
Caitlyn Jenner. Yeah.
Caitlyn. So, do you prefer Olympic? I thought this would be easy for you, Ben, because you're kind of like the Olympic guy. But then again, maybe you like Caitlyn. Maybe you think Caitlyn's hot. Okay, here's another question for you. Who do you think is hotter, Bruce Jenner or Caitlyn Jenner?
I appreciate
I think that's a fair question.
I'm not going to answer, but I appreciate true athleticism. I got to hang out and I got to ski with an Olympian. I got to play tennis with an Olympian. I know that these people, I have a friend, her daughter, her niece is playing in the U.S. Open. She practices 7 hours a day, 7 days a week. And that's how much effort these people put into their Olympic or their athletic career.
Seriously, so,
I'm going to say I'll appreciate Bruce Jenner. I still don't understand the whole gender change thing. I don't want to aggravate anybody on the call, but it's still, a lot of it just doesn't make sense to me.
Well, here's the thing. I think it's totally cool. So I'll just put it out there since nobody else wants to mention it. So I love Bruce Jenner because he was an Olympian. I mean, like, he's like a stud. He's like doing the Olympia thing. He's on the box of Wheaties. How cool. And then he's like, well, I've done this manly thing for a while. So why not be a woman? Because being a woman is better anyway. So even though he's not quite exactly like me and Jennifer, it's pretty cool. I mean, I'm like, variety is the spice of life. So why not? So I applaud the fact that he was married to Kris Jenner, Kardashian, or Kardashian Jenner, whatever, did all of that. And he just decided, you know what? I'm sick of this. I don't like her anymore. I don't like women. I want to be Caitlyn. So I have to say, good for him, her, whatever. I dig it.
Not whatever.
I admire it. I'm sorry?
It's her. It's not whatever. Her.
I know, but I'm just saying the transition as we're comparing. And I love Bruce Jenner, but I love Caitlyn Jenner too. For me, I think it's great. Why not be? For, you know, look, I'm a libertarian first and foremost. Be whatever the hell you want to be. If it makes you happy, screw everybody else. If they don't like it, who cares? So
USA.
I mean, that's what I love about our country. I mean, seriously, you can do that. You can do whatever you want. So, I mean, and I think Bruce Jenner, Caitlyn Jenner now is a good example of that, because we should have the freedom, have a free country, the freedom to do whatever the hell you want to. So I am all for Caitlyn. Good for you. You're fabulous. I mean, anyone who doesn't like it, screw them. They're unhappy. It's like, you're like, yeah, I'm tired of that. Let's just move on. This is what I'd rather be. I want to wear dresses and makeup and do my new thing. How great is that?
Criticize the Olympics.
I'm sorry? He was an Olympian. Think about it. What a difference that is, though. That's what I'm saying, how extraordinary it is. This guy was an Olympic, I mean, like, he, Olympic hero. He was like the man of mans. I mean, so masculine. And then decides that, well, you know, I really don't feel that way anymore. And then he changes totally. I think that takes a lot of courage. And I think it takes a lot of, you know, just, I don't know, what's the word I'm looking for, Michael? I know you don't have a wide vocabulary, but I'm just looking for...
I wanted to say balls. It takes a lot of balls to do that.
She already
did that at the roast. She's done all the bits at the Comedy Central roast. So
it's a lot of roast.
You know, that's just interesting that he was one of our biggest Olympians, and now I'm running for governor of California. I mean, I just think it's cool. You know, I mean, if you're a star, you're a star, and you're like someone who's extraordinary and does things. I mean, who would ever write that story? I think it's great, but that's just me.
Well, we could have a Terminator for the governor. Why not Caitlyn Jenner?
Or a bankrupt reality TV host. Sure. Let's see.
And I think she
guy who starred in the Killers and the Bedtime for Bonzo movies. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's right. Exactly.
Peanut farmer from Georgia who loves the Allman Brothers. That's pretty cool.
I mean, I'm for Caitlyn. I mean, look, if I was in California, I would vote for Caitlyn Jenner for sure. Right, Jennifer? I mean, I think she would be great. And I think she looks great. And I don't know.
Got to give some policies first.
Well, that's true. But it's not like Arnold had a lot of policies. I mean, you know, and he won.
That's the thing. You can't call down. You got to retire the left coast if you have Schwarzenegger, Reagan, and Nixon there. That's such an old, old hack.
But Nixon doesn't fit in. But you got to love Nixon too for other reasons. And the movie Nixon, well, you know, Henry Kissinger was
not talking about that. Talking about reality.
We always bring it around. There's no 6 degrees of Kevin Bacon. That's like one. It's like 2 degrees of Paul Sorvino.
Oh, absolutely. You bet.
Michael, you are so drunk. Michael, you're just drunk, slobbering. So. So, okay, so since you don't want to comment, and, you know, I mean, I don't know. Nobody has to comment on Caitlyn Jenner, but I like her, so I think it's cool.
Well, you asked me, and I'll confess this on myself. I'll make this confession. There are some blind spots in my knowledge. I grew up with Bruce Jenner, but I know like next to nothing about anything Kardashian, whatever it is. And it took me actually several years before I realized this person called Caitlin was in fact the former Bruce. I thought they were right, separate Kurt. People.
Okay. I did not know.
I didn't know that because I have the anti-Kardashian button on my television.
That's perfectly so all right.
Anytime anything would come up, I don't keep up with them. I don't know.
Good for you.
Yeah, and
they're canceled. They're canceled, yeah. And I assume you didn't see the sex tape that Michael loves. It's his favorite.
That's the show next Saturday for the seniors.
Someone needs to request it. Yeah.
Kardashian sex tape.
We'll send you the Bob Crane box set, Kurt. That'll go.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Oh yeah, Bob Crane.
Give Hogan's Heroes a whole new meaning.
What, Jennifer?
I was gonna say, one of the things that I like about getting older is that you can kind of reinvent yourself every 10 or 20 years because.
Well, he did that to a she.
He did the whole Kardashian thing, and then now he's the.
I know. I admire that. I mean, he is a survivor, and he's doing whatever he wants. I love that. In my opinion, as we're talking about the Olympics a little bit, it's the American way to be able to do what you want. You have the freedom in China when they shoot them down or something. I mean, I don't think it'd even be allowed. I mean, they're real, yeah, that's, you know, China's funny about that kind of thing, you know? So anyway, I think it's great because I just love that the fact that our country has so much freedom. And I think people should do whatever they want to do. As long as you're not hurting anyone else, they should be able to do whatever they want to do. So back to the Olympics. Simone Biles.
Oh, yeah.
So
why we watch the Olympics?
Crummy that people were giving her a hard time because she needed a break. And then they found out that her, I mean, you know, if people, look, it's up to you. If you train all of this time and you do whatever and you don't feel like doing it, I mean, you better be focused if you're getting on that bar, or you better be focused if you're flipping around 18 times. If your head's not in it, you could get hurt.
Yeah, who was the tennis player that criticized her and then he threw a McEnroe level shit fit after losing? So
And why? What right. is that? So it, I think
it takes back to maybe Carrie, you know, the whole Carrie Strug thing of the whole theatricality and how dramatic it was for her to be carried. And that's kind of from that toughen up you know, shit or get off the pot phase of athletics. So you know, I think it's got a different look now because this one athlete finally said, no, I'm not going to do it. So bully for her on that.
Mm-hmm. But, I agree. That's her choice.
But yeah.
And it's not like she hasn't done enough already. Why don't you say thank you for, you know, being the Olympics for our country. And if she wants to take a break or not do it, whatever, support her. I mean, you know, so I thought that was really, she got really crummy treatment. Yeah, so, you know, but then she went back to the bars. Now, I don't know what happened. Do you all know the situation? Has she done it yet, or did she compete?
She did the balance beam, and she won the bronze medal.
Great. Wonderful. Okay. Look, an Olympic medal is an Olympic medal.
Yeah.
But she has, I don't know, she has several. So you know, yeah, she's good.
She's got a lot.
Yeah, so I kind of admired the fact that, you know, she did that, and then people were criticizing her, which was horrible. I mean, and then she's like, well, okay, I decided to do the balance beam. And then she just picks up a bronze, like she's picking up the check for lunch. She's that talented.
Being armchair athletes out here on the internet.
Because she's that talented.
Well, and I like the fact that she was part of a team that would let her do that. I mean, thinking back, if Nadia Comaneci had decided that this was an off day.
She needed a gulag.
Her family would have been assassinated in Romania. Sure.
Or worse, sure. Larry Nassar.
Yeah.
Thanks, Matthew, for bringing that one up. And isn't that Indianapolis?
What's your subject, mister?
Isn't that your hometown? Do you know Larry? I'm just asking.
No, I'm sorry. I'm not a 14-year-old girl. He doesn't know me. no, there was a
oh,
great
that's so horrible.
There's a great documentary called Athlete A, and the Indiana Film Journalists Association gave it the Hoosier Award because of the Indianapolis Star breaking that story. I'm afraid I'm the guy that's going to bring up some of the ugly stuff. How many bribes went to cities so they could host the Olympics and then, you know, lose buttloads of money after the Olympics go away with empty stadiums and empty arenas. So,
you gotta take
the inspirational stories with the corrupt stories. That's a part of it.
Matthew, no. I appreciate you bringing that up because that's like a big deal. I mean, how this guy got away with that forever and ever, it's disgusting. And you know, we have three Hoosiers on, no, we have four Hoosiers actually on the show today. And of course, Indianapolis, Michael and Ben, I'm gonna give you a quiz. Uh-oh. What is Indianapolis known for? Not the, it's known for the Indianapolis 500, but regarding sports, and I know you, the rest of you know this, but what is it known for sports?
Indiana
basketball, the Hoosiers.
Yeah.
Right, that's fair. That's what everybody thinks. Right. And that is absolutely true. Absolutely
and
true.
I'm a big David Letterman fan. I loved
thank
Letterman.
Thank you, fellow Ball State graduate. Appreciate
yep.
that.
No,
thank
I ain't you. Been to... I've been to almost, I think, 15 different shows, and cool. I have not watched late night television since Dave left. Nothing.
Nobody's as good as Dave. I agree.
No, and to be in the audience and watch how effortlessly he really loved his audience, he would, and he did some weird things, but he loved
things.
Entertaining. Yeah.
Yep.
And he was not a New Yorker.
Were you around when he was the weatherman in Indianapolis? Did you?
No, I came here in, I grew up in Michigan. So I my freshman year at Ball State was 88. So my one Indiana pop culture thing was my freshman year was the last full season. Sammy Terry was on TV. So I got to watch him.
I love Sammy Terry.
But no, Letterman had a C scholarship. He had a scholarship for C.
I talks about that all the time.
Yeah. To get it really kind of bummed me out. So
you have to get straight C's. Isn't it straight C's to be able to get the David Letterman scholarship?
So in order for him to get it, his GPA was too high, so he had to take some classes and flunk. Get his GPA down, and then he got it.
There was I loved him literally. I watched him when I was in college, and I'd have to even in high school. I think I'd come home from work at night. And I have to do my homework. And back then he was on at 12:30. And I'm like, I like this guy. So that was probably 83, 84. Watched him in college. And then literally watched the last show. And I think he felt pushed out after a while.
Yeah.
But I'll tell you, if you look online, he was, I think he was very close to Robin Williams. He was in a Mork and Mindy episode long ago. He played some really... He played like a shyster that was trying to scam them out of money. Mm-hmm. And then he was on the Carol Burnett show. And he and.
David Letterman?
No, look it up.
I think the second.
Oh, no, the Mary Tyler Moore show.
The Mary Tyler Moore had a variety show.
Yep.
That Michael Keaton was a player, Letterman was a player.
Yep, and Michael Keaton and Letterman.
Wow.
Yeah.
It's a deep dive. I remember him doing an HBO comedy special back when HBO. First came into fruition. So all right, now
see the weather and say, oh, screw that, I'm not talking about that. Funny weather, man.
Were you trying to mention for Indiana the NCAA headquarters?
Indianapolis is known as the amateur sports capital of the world, so they do a lot of preliminaries, you know, for the Olympics, a lot of sporting events, whatever, and that's how NASA ended up getting with all these girls. No, but Indiana, I mean, it's got it going on when it comes to sports. And you were talking about the hockey movie, which I'm sure is lovely. But Hoosiers is the best sports movie of all time. Everybody thinks that who has a brain. Oh my God, Matthew, no, do not do this to me. Oh my God. I can't.
No, sorry. Raging Bull.
Raging Bull. Yeah, that's pretty good too.
Oh my God. Angelo on, my very good friend.
And I've had Angelo on my show.
I'm sure you have, but I want him on this show so you can say, no, Raging Bull's better than your movie.
No, it's not that. It's not, well, if one's going to compile lists, and we're such a list-oriented society, who cares? But no, I enjoy
him so much.
But
I'll give you a break because you're not from here. You're from Michigan, so I get it. That's different.
Yeah, but that's like me saying Tiger Town is the best sports movie ever made because it involves the Detroit Tigers, or For Love of the Game. It's not. But no, Raging Bull is just as relevant today when it comes to boxing. Slapshot is just as relevant today, if not more so, when it comes to sports, entertainment, and violence in sports.
But what about The Cutting Edge?
That's yours. Watched that a lot when you were younger, right? Yeah. Every generation has their date movie, especially date sports movie, and that's I can see that's.
And here's your big question of the day, Matthew, and I want you to really be prepared. I want you to gird your loins.
Yes, dear. Goodfellas.
But yeah, we already went over that.
Yeah, when in doubt, answer Goodfellas. No, but what's your?
What movie is better?
Uh oh.
The Cutting Edge. Now, do you all know what movie this is? The Cutting Edge. Jennifer, I love this movie.
It's two skaters and they don't like each other.
It's all they do. What are you talking about? At the end, they like, I love you. I love you too.
I know what you're going to say. Are you going to say the Will Ferrell movie?
No.
Blades of Glory? No. Let her Cutting Edge or what, dear? No.
You mean like the racing movie?
No. The skating movie. Go ahead. Continue.
That was horrible.
You know what? But I like the race car movie with Tom Cruise. Nobody likes it but me, but I love it.
Days of Thunder.
It's awesome.
Cutting Edge or what?
Okay, but let's go back to The Cutting Edge, mm-hmm. which I love, mm-hmm. or Xanadu.
Oh,
the place where nobody loves.
Feel better?
It's Xanadu. And you know what? They roller skate, so there's a sporting event with that too. They're very sporty.
Yes, I forgot about the roller disco
roller derby
back in 1978.
I don't know where you are, the shooting star. So anyway, so of those two movies, if you had to sit and watch, which one would it be? The Cutting Edge with D.B. Sweeney, or would it be Xanadu with Gene Kelly?
Are you putting a gun to my head, dear?
I am.
I don't see one. All right, here's the.
We've got one. I've got a rocket launcher.
Before I answer, have you made Paul watch both of those?
He would never do that.
Well, then there's my answer.
He would never watch either one of those movies.
How should I set myself on fire with regular gas or unleaded gas?
There's no way he would watch either one.
Because I adore you, I would probably watch Xanadu more than that before Cutting Edge.
Really?
Yeah. It's so long as I have a lot of this.
Well, Gene Kelly is lovely, and so is, you know.
Oh yeah, Olivia Newton-John. That, of course. And they have, you know, I do the Whenever You're Away From Me, the 1940s number. Hey, and here's the thing. It actually sounded like a 1940s number as opposed to those disco songs from the 50s in Greece.
In Greece, too, I didn't like.
Oh, there's a heavy cult of people that love Greece, too.
Like Greece, too.
I think they're in their late 20s.
You like that? Yeah, I don't know why I couldn't get into that. I didn't care for it. But, I mean, I like Greece when everybody was way old. You know, we talked about that. They're like 50, and they're
apparently
like
the Grease 2 kids are in their late 20s, and just it wasn't convincing enough.
I agree.
No, there's a serious cult of people that prefer Grease 2 over Grease. Jennifer,
I like it better, but I think part of it is because I was too young for Grease.
Thank you very much. I know I'm an old lady, and Michael's like, well, I don't know what you're talking about, but I'm gonna make it.
I like that cool rider.
I'm going to bring it back to the Olympics.
Very good.
Thank you. Thanks for being a good host helper.
No, don't thank me. This is going to be bad.
Uh-oh. It always is.
Vin has to go.
He's sorry.
I wish Vin loved it. Cardio tennis.
I'll give you an update next week.
The proper shorts.
Cardio tennis.
Yeah.
Enjoy.
Have a good weekend. Thank you, everybody.
North American.
Enjoy.
Bye-bye.
So, Michael, what are you talking about? Because I have a big question for Matthew after this. Go ahead.
That wasn't it?
I was thinking.
Take a one.
Master story, and he should do all the Grease musicals.
Go, Grease Lightning. Go, go, Grease Lightning. I mean, you know, Grease 2 doesn't have that. I mean, you know, Jennifer, kind of that song kind of sad and pathetic as to Grease Lightning.
Don't they have a song about sex ed in Grease too?
See, that would work. That would work.
But I understand it's maybe a generational thing for you young pups. I understand that. That's okay. right? So, but Matthew doesn't like, well, do you like Grease at all, Matthew?
There's dozens of musicals I could watch before Grease.
Okay. Understood. But at the time it was pretty cool. Okay, but do you like Saturday Night Fever?
I like Saturday Night Fever, but I also don't forget what Saturday Night Fever is really about.
I know. It's not about the dance. I brought it up because you're like, you people don't understand. It's a terrible, dark, seedy movie.
It is a dark film.
But you're a critic. I mean, everybody else just kind of looks at John Travolta with his tight pants and his wiener sticking out there. I mean, that's what they look at. And his big old pompadour hair. You know what I mean? And then he's combing it and it's real big. And then they're dancing. The music's really good with the Bee Gees. That's what most people get out of it. You go for the dark, dirty.
Oh, me, what was written? Yeah, how dare I go for what the screenwriter wanted to make?
Because you're a film critic. That's what you do. That's why we love you.
I love you too, but it's just...
Look, it's not that I'm giving you a hard time, really. I'm just saying you're a true, wonderful, amazing film critic. That is what you do. You're doing your job. And the rest of us are just like, la, 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 watching movies. Or I am, because I like Xanadu. And I dig the cutting edge. I like those movies. And I like Caitlyn Jenner. I mean, you know, I like all that stuff, you know?
I'll give you one. Watch Caitlyn in Can't Stop the Music. If you love disco musicals,
I do.
Watch Can't Stop the Music. Steve Guttenberg, Valerie Perrine, Caitlyn Jenner, and the Village People. And it's directed by Nancy Walker. This is, you know, cocaine was involved getting this film made. It's a big, big dumpster fire of camp.
I would love that.
Oh, then look for it. Look for it. I have it downstairs. And, you know.
So if it's like a movie with disco in it, for whatever reason, I just go right to it. I mean, I love it. I think it's
this happening. Is in your wheelhouse right here, love. Look, I don't know if it's streaming. I own a physical copy of it, but man, it is ridiculous.
Because you're a very smart film critic. I
love Ingmar Bergman and Federico Fellini. I love blaxploitation and kung fu as well, just equally. So, but we kind of get lumped into the Statler and Waldorfs when it comes to art criticism. That's fine.
I think you probably love the 70s in a different way than I do. I have that feeling that you resent my disco love of the 70s and the fun and fluffy, like, ew. And even though Studio 54 was like so dark and like whatever, I watched the movie and I'm like, oh my God, they're like in glitter and like, what's it? They all look cute and pretty. But then at the end, the guy shuts down. I don't know. I like the movie.
Me Duff thinks the queen protests too much.
No, I wanted to be there. I wanted to be with Brooke Shields. Everybody hated that. Brooke Shields, a child. She shouldn't be here. Okay, I get that. But still, she was a Studio 54. And then she did all that other stuff, like a prostitute at 12, you know? So that's...
Pretty baby, yeah.
But she's a lovely woman. And she's...
Oh, yeah. Emma knows her. My daughter knows her as Hannah Montana's mom.
Lovely.
So talk about reinventing yourself.
She's a good girl.
Yeah.
So, Kurt, you've been so quiet. I mean, you're thinking about that doctorate. You're thinking about, how am I going to get all my stuff from Bloomington down to Vanderbilt? What am I going to do? My gosh. I mean, I'm going to study for my doctorate after my 500 master's degree. But I want to know if, you know, have you enjoyed the Olympics, or have you really not had time to deal with it?
I pay attention to the Olympics every time, and I've been to several of them. And I sort of make it a hobby to travel around to different places that have held the Olympics, because we were talking about things that get sort of left behind. The picture I've got behind me right now is I'm standing on the glass floor of the Calgary Tower, which is 60 stories up. And that's 600 feet down between my feet there. And Calgary was one of the places that hosted the Olympics for Canada, one of three places that have hosted the Winter Olympics in Canada. And after they hosted it, they turned the city into an Olympic training ground. So it kept going. And I did a comedy festival there in Calgary just a few years ago. And that's how I got to go up there. And I think Vin was talking about Banff as being very nearby. You can go up this tower and see the Rocky Mountains in the distance, and it's a wonderful town. This tower is just around the corner from Chinatown. But I've been to Vancouver, and the other picture I had up before was the Olympic rings on the Helsinki Stadium in 1952, which was trying to sort of bring the Olympics back after World War II had sort of shattered most of Europe. And I like the Olympics themselves. I've actually been to the one in Salt Lake City, the one in Atlanta, the one in Lake Placid, the one in Athens in 2004. Several things like that. So I've loved those a lot, but I love the idea of the Olympics more than anything else. I love the idea of bringing the countries together and trying to find a way for people of different nationalities, different races, different colors, different everything to compete in a safe and worthwhile environment. And that always makes me sorry when politics intrude. But yeah, I really love the Olympics.
Well, I think we all do. And it's wonderful. And the United States is doing very well during this Olympics. And they always do. I mean, you know, they always come in the powerhouse in the end. And Jennifer, you've got to go. So as you leave, do you have like one like parting statement about the Olympics, or maybe a memory about it, or are you watching a particular sport closely, or is there something that stands out for you?
I just think it's a great way for the countries to battle each other and not actually kill anybody. So I like the camaraderie, I like the patriotism, all that kind of stuff. That's what I like about the Olympics, because we did the early stuff. We didn't get into it, but like in Germany when they were in the 40s, when they thought they were supreme and we were able to kick their butts and some things. And and then
Jesse Owens, 1937.
Yeah. Although, the white supremacy stuff, that was pretty cool.
I just wish Jesse would have done this as he was crossing the finish line.
Yeah.
Five links ahead of everybody.
Totally. But look, I mean, you know, this is what I love. I love the fact that at the Olympics, the United States, when they come in, everybody looks, everybody's like in awe. I mean, our country is a very new country compared to really the most of the rest of the world, but we are kicking ass always, you know, the best country in the world. But at the Olympics, I mean, it's just wonderful. I love that, like you all. And it just encapsulates the fact that our country is just, look, people aren't crossing the border in about a million other countries. You know, everybody's, you know, trying to get into our place, because our country, because it's the best place in the world. So I think with the Olympics, we can all celebrate that and be happy that we're Americans and cheer on our team and see how the rest of the world, they're all jealous, just jealous of the fact that the USA, USA, and we're just kicking ass across the board still. It is what it is. Bye-bye, high chair. See ya. Nobody's crossing the border in your country, are there? Nope.
But one of the things about the Olympics, though, is that there's usually, occasional personalities aside, usually good sportsmanship. And when you see someone who is clearly excellent at their craft, clearly the top in the world, it doesn't really matter ultimately what the nationality is.
The Thai movement was cool. There's great stories, and they all don't have to involve the athlete's a member of somebody from the athlete's family dying, which becomes a kind of a go-to with the network. So everybody has a story, kind of similar to what I said about the Academy Awards. Hey, if a shot putter from Czechoslovakia is great on the stand or does a good interview, that's, you know, I think that's more fascinating than the pre-prepared robotic kind of athlete that's supposed to answer the same questions the same way. So yeah, or you know, moments like that, like the tie, like the other part is it's fun to drive through small towns and see signs that they are the home of
an Olympic athlete,
medalist kind of thing. That's it's very cute.
It kind of brings the whole world together. I mean, yeah. In my opinion, it's the one event, name another one, that brings the entire world together. And then you know, if you see like a someone from another country struggling, because I'm always going to be for USA, but if you see an athlete that's struggling and they had like a cramp or they have something, you still want them to do well. Everybody roots for them. It's a humanitarian effort. So it's really amazing. And you all know what Nike means, right? Do you know the story with Nike? I know, Kurt, of course you know. Tell us.
The Greek god or the...
Is it from the Greek meaning just do it?
Yeah. Well, no, not quite. But it's sort of Olympics or Olympics related.
Yeah, you get the goddess of victory in Nike, and the idea of the Olympics, of course, comes from the ancient Olympiad. There were actually several sequences of games that were held, not all of which were four-year games, but in the late 1800s, Baron de Coubertin wanted to resurrect something. He thought the logistics of the world were such that they could handle something once every 4 years. And that's why we got the four-year schedule rather than sort of two or three or anything else like that. And it's remarkable. There's a wonderful and wonderfully bad history miniseries on the first Olympics that David Ogden Stairs was in, and it's like a four-hour miniseries on the first Olympics in 1896 and how the Americans got involved in that. Because it was really Harvard and Princeton and maybe a few other universities that sent athletes over. We didn't have an official team, but Baron de Coubertin knew that if the United States was involved in some way, that would help the success of this. Also, the British had a sort of pan-Britannic games going on that took a lot of their athletes away at the same time. But if you watch this video, it's sort of a really soppy kind of a peon to the Olympics, and it makes you feel good. And then you have to realize that half of the things they introduce to it actually aren't historically correct. But it sort of gives you a wonderful feeling. The first person who won the marathon in the Olympics of the modern day,
to Nike, by the way,
was a Greek man who then declined all honors afterwards. But he considered his inspiration to be a divine inspiration to run for Greece. And of course, the celebration of the divine, like Nike, was part of the old Olympics.
Then again, Bibi Bekele didn't get a shoe endorsement deal either.
So, you know, marathon comes from the you know, it's like from a war from the Greeks, and he ran 26 miles or whatever, and at the end, because he was there to give the message of victory. And Nike is like, victory, Nike. And then the dude dropped dead. I'm just saying, it's just kind of a funny story.
Yes! He won!
Kind of like Jim. I mean,
I'm not kidding. I'm not kidding. I mean, that's where Nike
comes from. Well, it's like,
And then the dude dropped dead because he ran his ass off for 26 miles. You know, like, that's where a marathon came from, because he went from like a, in Greece or whatever, a place called Marathon, right? Or, you know, I'm there, to there, 26 miles, and then he was like, Nike! And then he dropped it.
If he had only carved up at the old spaghetti factory the night before.
I know, totally. I mean, or on the way, or like something. Yeah. On the way.
He ran from the battlefield to announce to the citizens of Athens that the battle had been won, because they didn't have Twitter back then.
But, he had run 26 miles as fast as he could and killed them off.
But the thing is, the marathon today is a little bit longer than that old marathon. They extended the distance of the marathon for the first London Olympics, because the royal family wanted to see the race, so they extended it onto the grounds of the palace, and we have kept that extended version ever since.
Well, what is that extended version, Kurt?
It's a little over 26 miles, but that's why it's a weird amount.
26.2 something. Okay.
Yeah. That's why it's a weird amount rather than a set amount. I think the first one that was run in the modern Olympics was 25 miles. Okay. It was a set number of miles, and because the metric system hadn't quite taken hold yet internationally. But the reason why we have that weird amount is because of the London Olympics. And that's one of the things that becomes interesting, too, is how traditions grow up in the Olympics, and how often if they do something one time, they'll just stick with it ever thereafter.
Well, you know, the British are so bossy. I mean, when they get involved, it just happens because they think they still have the British Empire. You know, I mean, they were like telling everyone what to do for so many years and in so many places. So they get to extend the marathon. Why? But they were the boss. And that's the way to, now I still think the Queen's the boss, but when it gets down to Meghan and otherwise, So let's, about time to go. So it's great that, you know, we're all enjoying the Olympics, but Matthew.
Yes,
ma'am. I'm sure you're disappointed that Susan Anton didn't ring it.
I put on a shirt with buttons too.
Let me tell you what I'm going to do. So Susan Anton, of course, I work with her agent, you know, very closely or whatever, but today just wasn't a good day. They were going to try, but it didn't work. So I might be able to get her just for you.
Uh-oh.
I mean, you know, I could hand her over to you and you could, like, you know, she could be on your show.
I'll put on my smoking jacket then.
Yeah, you better.
I tried to.
We'll get Susan Anton, the Golden Girl, maybe on here or maybe there. We'll talk about it. But you know.
I wound up watching a couple of her films last week to prepare. So there, you know,
I know you did.
There's some heavy preparation here. This is serious journalism. Serious.
Yeah, well, Golden Girl, I mean, this, you know, the Olympic movies, I mean, I think there are a handful, right? I mean,
there's a lot. There's, I mean, Miracle and Chariots of Fire, even somebody like Walk Don't Run, which was Cary Grant's last film, which was shot at the 1964 Olympics in Tokyo. I mentioned Bibi Bakilia. This was a guy, I can't remember what country he was from in Africa, but he won the marathon barefoot, running through the cobble streets of Rome. And they used it at the beginning of Marathon Man as I think it was Hoffman's inspiration for that. Let's see, I'm trying to, Munich, of course, if you want to go dark.
Yeah.
Foxcatcher, if you want to go dark. We've mentioned Ray.
Foxcatcher, oh my God. I tried to watch that movie out. I went to that premiere, I'm like, did I have to see this movie?
Race, I know there's that.
I showed that at Beltrace, yeah.
That's right. Yeah. So there, I mean, and Miracle. I really enjoyed. I love Kurt Russell and Miracle, and that's a fun picture. So they're out there because it's you get the training stuff. You get coaches, actors love guy actors, and I'm sure ladies do too. Love monologues in locker rooms. It's easy fodder to grandstand and chew away at and go at it. So
and don't forget the cutting edge.
No, I won't forget the cutting edge, dear. You know what? You and I will run the Blockbuster and we'll get, you know, we'll get something from Domino's and we'll watch the cutting edge together.
I think you should have a double feature of the cutting edge and I, Tonya.
There you go.
Don't forget I, Tonya.
No, can't forget that. Which owes a lot to Goodfellas in its storytelling style. So
No, Kurt, that's totally, you've totally brought, like, to the end of the show, the best part. I, Tonya.
Way to go, Kurt. I wasn't going to go there, but way to go, man.
Anything Allison Janney. I'll always go with Allison
Janney.
That was a great
Allison
movie.
Yeah.
But of course, we all remember that when poor Nancy Kerrigan just got whacked in the knee. How horrible. How ghetto.
I met Tonya Harding at a radio morning show. Yeah, she was back when I was doing reviews on 1490 AM. There was a morning show, 99 ZPL, and this was when she was touring, doing her boxing thing, and she had a match in Indianapolis, and I just introduced myself and said hi, and then unsolicited was telling me how serious she was about being a boxer, and then took a few steps back and threw some punches, not really close, but just enough that I'm like, I thank you for your demonstration. I didn't ask anything. It was just really odd. I'm like, okay, good to see you.
You know, for some reason that makes sense.
Yeah, kind of. So,
you guys know the guy in I, Tonya that was played Richard Jewell.
Richard Jewell type. Yeah.
I met him at a comedy show. He did some stand-up comedy. You know, he's around my age, like mid-30s ish, and he said that he was a virgin. So,
God, thanks for sharing on Drinks with Dee Dee. We want to know that fact. That is very, very important.
I'm like, What's wrong
and he's
with
a liar. He's a freaking liar.
I'm like, you're no.
He was lying about fucking.
The very liar. But I was just like, why? What's wrong?
Who asked for this?
I know. I mean, seriously, did you really believe in Michael? I mean, come on, you know he's lying. Although he could be whacking off like 10 times a day and that's what he does.
Well, how big are his forearms?
I mean, you know, whatever.
You need a Popeye forearms?
That's but again, I'm back to, as long as it doesn't hurt anyone else, do whatever you want, dude. Don't care.
That was the only bomb he dropped.
Oh. Yeah, but that's a big bomb. Like, well, I'm a virgin. Okay. All right. Rich.
Oh, but you want to know this.
All right, Dick.
Yeah.
Do what you did there. That's.
All right. So before we go, so Matthew, I mean, do we want Susan Anton on the show? Because we can get her, but I feel like I don't have a theme with her now.
I can't find girl. It's not available to stream. I totally
no, it is not. It is not. You have
no,
to.
I've never seen it. I didn't even know. You know, I kind of can barely get her in my head. So I mean,
you, there is a YouTube film of it, but it is being riffed over by a couple of non Mystery Science Theater types. Otherwise, if you have those archaic cassettes, you know, like where Dee Dee and I are going to rent Cutting Edge and then go to Domino's. So it is not available.
At Kurt's place, we're gonna go and we're gonna like party with the, you know,
and get a cherry coke.
Yeah, Tanya, and we'll make it a triple feature. We'll throw in Chariots of Fire too, just
no,
for a curiosity.
I will tell you, no, the one to rent is the bronze.
The bronze.
Yeah, it's oh god, what's her name? She was on Big Bang Theory, but she plays a. She plays a skater who was like a gymnast. She was a gymnast.
What about the naked Mariel Hemingway show? Was that Olympics?
Personal best.
Was that Olympics?
Sure.
Kind of, sort of.
It is now that you brought it up.
They call it Xanadu.
That's a Xanadu.
Nice pipe.
Yeah.
Right. I know. Well, okay. Well, you know, I guess it's time to bring the show to an end, and everybody should give their best Olympic USA, whatever you like. But I have to say that I do love these athletes that are saying, I love our country. I'm so proud to be representing it. And, you know, and they've worked so hard, because if you think about it, these Olympians, wow, they put so much time into something that they have a very, very small chance of winning, if you think about it, and you put all this time in. So I always admire these Olympians, because it's a very difficult task. I mean, across the board, and then they win, and it's amazing. Doesn't matter if it's a gold, silver, or bronze, it is a win. So, you know, we should applaud them, be proud of our country. They're doing great. And, you know, let's just keep watching and keep supporting USA and all those folks out there doing a great job, and let's give them a toast and get the heck out of here.
Yep.
Cheers, everybody.
L'chaim. To North and South America.
In Xanadu. The place where nobody... Okay, no, that's not an Olympic movie.
No, it isn't. No. It is in your heart, and that's okay.
Well, roller skating is a sport. And, you know, Cool Runnings, I never finished that story, but, you know, we're going to get cut off. But, you know, Paul auditioned for that and got mad because he didn't get it. Mm-hmm. You know, Paul rarely doesn't get a part. But John Candy, in my opinion, is better, because Paul's a mob boss and John Candy's John Candy. So, and then when we watched it, Paul said, you know what? I think John Candy was perfect for that. You know, he's a good sport.
Well, and your husband can do comedy as well.
He can.
Yeah.
But, you know, he was a little bit, you know, grumpy about
that. Sure, if you didn't watch the role, I get that.
Because he said, I don't want to watch that. I said, why not? It's a great movie, because I don't want to watch it. And then he finally said, you know, I auditioned for it. But then we had the audition about Fredo. You know, you all know the story about that.
Right. Yeah.
So there, you know, Even on Paul's done like about 200 movies. I mean, there have been a few like bumps along the way.
There are many story. There are many famous stories about folks that didn't get it as opposed to those that do. So, right. And that's
curveballs along the way.
It would have been a dramatically different movie if Paul had been in it. I could see it getting an Oscar just because you would get sucked in performance about why he cheated.
Yeah, right. And I agree totally.
But I mean, I don't know, it could have played off well, the juxtaposition of the comedy versus the serious acting, but I know a lot of douchey writers would be like, oh, the tone's not considered, go fuck yourself, it's Paul Sorvino.
And now, he could have had one of the other, like, team members whacked, and it would have totally worked, and then they would have won right away. I mean, it would have changed everything. Whenever you're able to, when you're the boss and you have that power to get the other ones whacked, I mean, do you think the Olympic Committee is going to stand in the way of Paul Sorvino?
They don't stand a chance.
They don't have a chance. He knows people. He is people.
He is people.
All right, everybody. Happy Olympics. See you later.
All right. Salud.
Bye-bye.
USA. USA. USA!
USA! USA!
USA! Drinking should be a sport!
Bye-bye!
Bye-bye! Bye-bye! Olympia!
Get ready to cheer on Team USA! Sign up for Xfinity Internet and get a Flex 4K streaming box free and Peacock Premium included! Can your internet do that?
Restrictions apply. Not available in all areas. Peacock subscription required.
Xfinity, proud partner of Team USA!
With MailChimp, you get more than a URL. You get an all-in-one marketing platform to help drive sales with things like data-driven recommendations and powerful automation tools. Get started today at MailChimp.com/smartmarketing. MailChimp, built for growing businesses.